welcome back, and just to take you back to what we did in Act 2, Scene 1, if you remember, the text is right in front of you. Antonio and Sebastian, they reveal their conspiratorial best, if I may use the term. Especially Antonio is the more, you can say, the vicious of the two, right? But we know that this is a ploy, definitely planned by Prospero to reveal the true nature of these two conspirators, right? And that's why the minute they draw the swords and they are talking apart, Ariel re-enters and he was there. So my master, through his art, foresees the danger that you, his friend, are in. So he's singing in Gonzalo's ears to wake him up. Yes, and that's why, sends me forth, for else his project dies. What is his project? His project is to seek vengeance to a certain extent, to set right the wrongs that have happened in the past. And if Alonso and Gonzalo are killed, that will not be achieved. He has to show Alonso the true nature of the brothers, right? So they have to be awakened, and that's why he sings in Gonzalo's ears. And you see, the words are so revealing, and he says, while you are sleeping, open-eyed conspiracy is time to take. If of life you keep care, shake off slumber and beware. You are sleeping and you have allowed these conspirators to to show their ugly selves. So if you value your life, get up. So, and while Antonio is talking, let us be sudden, let us be quick, they're planning their attack. And Gonzalo, now good angels, preserve the king, and they wake. Yes, come on, get up. How now? Oh, awake, why are you drawn? So both of them get up, and then suddenly they see both of them with their swords drawn. Yes, Antonio and Sebastian have drawn their swords. Then why have you drawn your swords? And you see, Gonzalo said, what's the matter? Why are you with your swords drawn? He said, immediately, you see, Sebastian, such smooth liars they are. Whilst we stood here securing your repose, we heard a hollow burst of bellowing like wolves or rather lions. He said, we were watching, guarding over you, and suddenly we heard the screams of wild animals, and you were not woken up, you know, the question they're asking. Didn't it wake you up? I'm sure that's what woke you all up, because it really woke us up as well, and I heard nothing. You know why they heard nothing, because there was nothing. And Antonio, it was din to fright a monster, it was very loud, it was so loud that even a monster, it was to make an earthquake, yes, it was worse than the sound of an earthquake, it was the roar of a whole herd of lions. Exaggerations, but they have to at this point in turn. So Alonso definitely is asking Gonzalo, did you hear it? Gonzalo says, no. I mean, I heard a humming. That humming was Ariel singing in his ears, right, to wake him up. And that's why I got up and I see them with their weapons drawn. It's best we stand our guard, or that we quit this place. Yes. So now it is important that we are alert, or we have to leave this place and look for your son, look for Ferdinand. And then they naturally say, let's hope the animals spare him, yes. Then they move away. And Ariel's last line, Prospero, my lord, shall know what I've done. So king, go safely on to seek thy son. You know, the rhymed couplet that Shakespeare has often used most of the time to end a scene, right? So I'll go and tell Prospero how we have saved. He has, through his magic, saved another situation while they go to save Ferdinand, look for Ferdinand. Now, I'm moving to Act 2, Scene 2, because here you have another conspiracy brewing, but a kind of a subplot. Remember, the role of Caliban with Stefano and Trinculo will be a part of a subplot, which does not hinder the main plot, but perhaps adds on to the theme of conspiracy, because another conspiracy is going to be hatched here. Yes, and you know, it's another part of the island, and Caliban comes in with and you see, whenever Caliban comes in, it is always, you know, with that cursing. The entire speech here is, he's just cursing. He's working, right? He's been asked to carry the low wood, cut it and get it and stack it. That's the work that he does, ordered by Prospero. He's a slave. And he's cursing. Whenever you see him, what does he say here? I mean, he's cursing in such a, all the infection that the sun sucks up from bogs, fen, flats, or Prospero. Make him inch meal a disease. So he said that all the diseases that breed in the swamps and marshes or here on this island should infect Prospero, yes? Until, you know, like every part of Prospero should be infected in such a way that when he's walking, you know that he's a disease personified, as ugly as that, yes? And then, of course, he says that Caliban knows that he's very powerful. So he says that, oh, I'm sure that his spirits can hear me. Yes, and I'm sure they'll come and pinch me, and they frighten me, and they can even push me into the bog and swamp and lead me like a firebrand in the night. You know, those little, when you see fireflies in the night, you know, they'll sort of take me to the wrong path. Yes, and I know that Prospero does it all the time. He out of my way unless he bids them, but for every trifle are they set upon me, sometimes like apes. Now he gives an example. For every little thing, he uses his spirits to take revenge on me, to inflict pain on me. Yes, sometimes they come in the form of apes. Yes, and they make faces at me, they bite me, they grimace, and sometimes they come like porcupines. So you have a different... examples given of animals. You know, apes, naturally they imitate, they chatter. Porcupines, they are known for the kind of skins they have that help with their piercing, you know, like thorns, which can cause, you know, when you step on it, you will really hurt yourself. So sometimes they are lying on my path, yes, and I hurt myself when I walk. Sometimes snakes, he even talks of snakes who sort of wrap around me and with their forked tongues, cloven tongues, hiss me into madness, and it sort of drives me mad. And that's the kind of pain that Prospero keeps inflicting upon me, yes. Trinculo comes in, and when he sees Trinculo, see, he doesn't know that there are others on the island, so he believes that this is another of Prospero's spirit. Yeah, so he sent his spirits, I'll fall flat, perchance he will not mind me. So he said, I will lie on the flat, on the ground, and perhaps he will not see me there. Yes, Trinculo looks upon him. This is a passage that it comes often for reference to the context, and he says, now, what is this that I see here? Yes. He comes in because, see, remember there's a thunder and lightning going on, and he wants some shade in case there is more thunder and lightning. Here is neither bush nor shrub to bear of any weather at all, and another storm brewing. So he said that this is absolutely a flat ground. There's nothing that I can that can protect me if I can feel there's a storm brewing. So how do I protect myself? Yes, the way the wind is whistling, I know there is a storm coming up. Yes, there is a huge black cloud there, he says. Some black cloud, huge one, falls like for foul bombard that could shed his liquor. You know, it's like a black cloud, and it looks like a, you know, a liquor jug, and which will pour its content onto the earth. You know, something that like bucket full of all the venom that is going to be poured out of with the content, and that's what he says. It'll come pouring down, and what will I do then? Yes. Now you see, it's quite interesting what's going to happen now. Yes. And he says that I know not where to hide. I cannot. I can't find a hiding place. Yes, he says that I can't find any hiding place here. Then when he's looking around, you know what's going to happen. He's going to find. Yes, he will look at this little hump lying on the floor, and he will realize that this is somewhere that I can take refuge. Yes, so he says that then of course, and remember, Caliban has this kind of he is on the island, he is off the island, he is a monster. So he says that it's a very, very funny. I don't know what this creature is. Is it human? Is it alive? Or is it dead? Is it a man or is it a fish? Because there's a foul smell coming. You know, it's a fish-like smell when it is something which has been lying uncared for, and there's a stench that comes out of it. Yes, and a kind of not of the newest, poor John. Poor John here refers to a very kind of strange kind of a fish. And then he says, where I in England, and it is, you know, like I could use this creature and paint it up and make it like a display in one of the village fairs that could help me get some money. So you see, this is how the mind of Trinculo works. He's immediately thinking of how to benefit from the situation. He has seen this creature. Yes, and he says that it's very, very much like a salted fish, and I could have painted this, and there could be so many gullible people around who would come and pay a piece of silver to come and see this this strange creature. Yes, just like a man, he's smelling like a fish, and it'll be quite a novelty back in England. Yes, because there are people, there are fools who won't give money to help a beggar to sustain, but they would pay for their own pleasure, that is, pay to see a freak show. You know, you have these kind of shows in villages where you have a horse with two heads or a dog with four legs and things like that. You know, you keep reading about these strange things in papers. Now, of course, it's lesson, but these were very common things of the past. He said, yes, so this is a strange creature. It's got legs like a man, but it appears to have fins like a fish. And you know, he's feeling Caliban. He says, it's quite warm. It's alive, is it? Yes. Then suddenly he realizes perhaps it is not a fish. Perhaps it's a indigenous tribe. He belongs to an indigenous tribe, lives on this island, yes, and who is maybe affected by the same tempest that we were. Yes, and then there is thunder and Stefano comes in. So you have a scene where you have Stefano, Trinculo and Caliban together, and Stefano is, as very clear from the very beginning, is a drunkard. He comes in with a bottle and he's singing a song, and I'm not going into the songs. Honestly, they don't make any sense. Yes, here comes another storm, and he's singing, and so Trinculo decides that till the storm comes, he's going to hide under this creature here, because that's the only thing that's going to give him any protection. So he goes under that little hump of flesh, which is Caliban. And Stefano enters singing, right? And Caliban, you know, immediately, and the gist of, if you really want the gist of Stefano's song, is I'll never go out onto the sea, I will remain here on the island. Yes, and then he's talking about all those people on the ship, the bosun, the mariners, the master, everyone there. And then the typical sailor's song about who they left behind. And honestly, I'm not Then, of course, he says, to see, let us go to hang, and rotten song, it doesn't give me comfort, yes. But Caliban, now suddenly he feels somebody wriggling under his cloak, right? I won't call it a cloak, it's just a piece of cloth. So he thinks, what? It is a spirit of Prospero, yes. So he cries out, don't hurt me, yes. So Stephanos says, what's the matter? Have we devils? Suddenly he sees that little hump and he says, what do we see? Is this some creature of the island? Yes. Do you put tricks upon us with savages and men of land? Huh? I have not escaped drowning to be afeared now of your four legs. Now what has happened is he's seeing four legs. He's seeing the two of Caliban, the two of Trinculo. So he said, have I saved myself from this storm to come onto this island and be frightened of this strange creature? Yes, these uncivilized savages of these islands. And, you know, these entire tales that people who were traveling would bring back to England from the Indies. We're talking about the West Indies, yes. So I'm not going to be scared of this four legs. As proper a man as ever went on four legs cannot make him give ground, and it shall be said so again while Stefano breathes at his nostrils. You know, he talks a lot of rubbish, and he says that I don't run away from such things, yes. I'm not like the rest of them. He's actually drunk. So most of the time what he speaks, we don't understand. But Caliban keeps thinking that the spirit of Prospero is torturing him, yes. And what does Stefano say? This is some monster of the isle with four legs, who hath got, as I take it, an egg. So this must be a monster. Yes, I'll give him some relief. Yes, so he pours some liquor down Caliban's throat. Yes, and if I can recover him and keep him tame and get him to Naples, he's a present for any emperor that ever trod on neat's leather. Now you see what has happened with both Trinculo and Stefano. These are common workers in the king's court, yes. So for them, easy money. So what Trinculo thinks is exactly what Stefano is thinking. Is it supposed, if only this creature could speak the language like us, then I could sort of cure him of this disease that he has, the fever that he has. I could tame him and then I could take him back to Naples and present him in the court of the emperor, the King of Naples, and I would be rewarded for it as being one of the strange creatures that I've got back from the island. So each of them is trying to think of how to make a quick buck with this creature of the island. And what is Caliban saying? Don't hurt me. Don't hurt me. I'll do my work. The same thought. What does Stefano say? He's in a fit now because he doesn't understand what Caliban is saying, right? He's just mumbling and talking to himself, and Stefano is too drunk to even understand. So he's having a fit and he's talking nonsense, and I'll give him a liquor. He's never drunk this liquor before. It will soothe him down. Yes, and then I can get a lot of money. He's only thinking about how he can get that extra money to make a quick buck. Yes. And when he's speaking, you see, suddenly, Trinculo hears Stefano's voice, right? So, Stefano is pouring this liquor into Caliban's mouth, right? It'll stop you and open your mouth, drink it up. You don't know who your friends are. And Trinculo suddenly, I recognize that voice. Yes, God. And what does he think? But I thought Stefano is drowned. So he believes that's a ghost of Stefano that has come. Oh God, help me, he cries. And Stefano has heard Trinculo now. So he says that, my God, four legs, two voices, a most delicate monster. So it is absolutely a comic relief, the scene is, yes. And a special monster because four legs, two voices, he's hearing Caliban's voice and he hears Trinculo's voice, yes. And somehow he says that one voice is abusive, the other voice is more quieter, and okay, but he keeps pouring liquor, yes, into Caliban's ears, and then suddenly Trinculo shouts out Stefano. Ah, and then Stefano's other mouth calling my name, that's what he says. Yes, does thou other mouth call me? Mercy, mercy, this is a devil, no monster. I leave him, I have no long spoon. Yes, I have no long spoon means, you know, this is a long spoon here refers to the way that, you know, you sort of protect yourself from the devil by holding this long wooden spoon. It's a kind of superstitious belief, yes. I don't want to mix up anything with the devil. I have nothing with the devil to do. Then Trinculo, of course, he says, if you are Stefano, then speak to me. I'm Trinculo. Don't be scared. Yes. So then Stefano says, okay, Trinculo, if you are Trinculo, then come out. Yes. And then starts pulling each other's legs, which is... and then, of course, then they start talking. And then he says, the gist of it is... Trinculo says, I thought you were dead, struck by lightning. So, and then they believe that, okay, we are the only two who have survived and out of the ship. So only two from Naples who have survived, yes. And then Caliban, I swear upon that bottle to be thy true subject, for the liquor is not earthly. So immediately he realizes that they are marvelous creatures. Because that liquor that he has drunk has put him on a, you know, has given him a very comfortable feeling. Yes, so I will worship you. You're worthy of worship. Yes, Stefano and Trinculo are still talking about how they escaped. How did you survive? How did you get here? Did you swim ashore on the bark of a tree? Sorry. And then Stefano said that he used the barrel which had all the bottles of wine, and he used the barrel to keep himself afloat. So you know that for Stefano the barrel of wine is so important, because he is a drunkard. And he said, I've kept the cellaries in the rock by the seaside where my wine is hid. So he floated on that and he's kept it there. And Caliban, I will be your subject. I swear by the bottle that you all must be gods. Yes. And why do you think Caliban is thinking? He says that he wants to get out of Prospero's clutches, right? So he believes that if these people have so much of power, he doesn't understand. He has not seen such a thing before. Then he could use these two to get out of Prospero's clutches, right? And then then they suddenly realize what they are. Yes, and... what they have around them, yes, and of course this kissing of the Bible and swear by the Bible and kissing the rock and etc. etc. And then Trinculo says that you know, what is this? By this good light, this is a very shallow monster. Yes, has thou not dropped from the heaven? Caliban says, out of the moon I do assure it. I was a man in the moon when time was. You know, like. Man in the moon when time was, it is again referred to, we are going back to the same little nursery rhyme, the man in the moon, yes. And but then what does Trinculo say? I mean, because swear by this and kiss the book, when Trinculo sees Caliban doing that, drinking and swearing, and you be my god, he's telling Stefano, Trinculo says, my god, he is a weak, yes, a monster who is going to swear by the bottle and fall at Stefano's feet is a very shallow monster. Yes, so he realizes that this, I was feeling frightened of this creature, but I mean, it's a silly monster, foolish, yes. So, and Stefano is taking advantage, kiss my feet, etc., etc. And then Caliban, he says what he said. He told Prospero, when Prospero first came to the island, I'll show you everything that is fertile on this island. Yes, I shall be your subject and I shall show you where the crabs grow. I shall show you the best springs. I'll pluck the berries. I'll fish for thee. I'll be your slave. In simple terms, I will serve you. I'll show you everything that you need to survive on this island. Yes. And I would want freedom from that tyrant who has kept me under his control for so many years. I will show you everything that is good upon the island. Yes. Yes. And then the roots, the crabs, how to catch it and how to catch the monkey, and sort of I'll take you where there are hazelnuts and I'll catch the birds for you. And so you see, what does it show? That Caliban's very nature shows that he is going to remain a slave all his life. Yes, he is just replacing, wanting to replace one monster for the other. And the only thing that he has to boast is to show the goodness of the island. Yes, and Stefano and Trinculo, the kind of people they are, they take advantage, especially Stefano. Okay, lead the way, show us the way. Yes, Trinculo, the king, and all our company. Else we drown, we will inherit here. So you see, anyone who comes to the island is thinking of inheriting it, thinking of owning it, right? So the island belonged to Sycorax. Prospero came, it belonged to him. When Ferdinand first came onto the island, he didn't see anybody, he thinks he's the king of this island. And then the same thought comes to the mind of Gonzalo. He says, if this island belonged to me, I would make a commonwealth of it. And then Stefano and Trinculo also think. So this entire theme of colonization, which was so rampant during the Elizabethan time, is reflected by everyone. And that is what Shakespeare wanted to highlight. Yes, even to the extent that it seeps down to even drunkards like Stefano. Yes, so brave monster, lead the way. Yes, we've got all our wine there. We will fill it up. Let's go. Let's find out who is your tyrant. And we will give you the freedom that you so want. So another conspiracy, if I look at this, is conspiracy to kill Prospero, also hatched by in the subplot, which doesn't deter us from the main plot, but adds on to the theme to a certain extent. The scene is more of a comic relief, right? So I hope you've understood. The next day we go on to the reference to the context questions, and we'll discuss a few important points, because some very important points have come out of this scene. Till then, stay safe, look after yourself. See you all soon.